The next force in microevolution comes from non-random mating. Non-random mating, there's several forms we can look at. First is close inbreeding, where you have, well, you get married to, you have a family with your sister or your mother, okay? When you do that, you're in effect putting your family through a founder effect. So here we have a plant that produces pollen, that's the plant sperm, and it has ova, so it has plant eggs, okay? Now, some plants can fertilize themselves. That's an extreme form of inbreeding, okay? So with this one, you'd have the same flower where you have the pollen coming off, going into this, going in and fertilizing the eggs. There are some flowers that actually have prohibitions. It's like, ooh, it's gross, I'm not gonna mate with myself. But a flower on this limb might mate with a flower in another limb. It's still genetically the same individual, but they kind of take a half-hearted attempt not to mess around with themselves, okay? Now, what happens with close inbreeding is it exposes mutant alleles, okay? Remember, we all carry a few mutations around. So, let's say your brother, who had that weird, you know, mutant form, he has a unique mutation, okay? But you don't. Okay, so if he then is lucky enough to start a family, okay, then his son and daughter may by chance possess his mutation, okay, both of them, because they're descended from him, okay? And if they marry each other, okay, there's a chance then all of a sudden that would never have happened otherwise, that you have this brand new mutation from their father, okay, they could end up in the homozygous form in their children. So the grandson here would be homozygous for allele that first appeared in his grandfather, okay? So rare recessive alleles are common. Most mutations are recessive. They just make things not work, but they're silent because the healthy version continues to produce a healthy protein, okay? But for rare recessive alleles, this kind of inbreeding is the only way that these kinds of homozygotes can be produced, okay? So, no, don't marry your sibling, okay? Now, the other form of non-random mating I want to discuss is called assortative mating. And this is where individuals seek partners with similar genotypes. So let's imagine we have a population of birds and we have two different alleles, okay, and we have several different genotypes here. And so we have this short-beaked bird that is kind of put off by the long beak of that other bird, and so it preferentially mates with one of its own kind, okay? This means in the next generation, these individuals that had the yellow beak were not able to mate, so their allele is much rarer in the next generation. They've been excluded, as it were, from the breeding pool, okay? Now, there are some real examples of this. Here is a fascinating case in snails, okay? We have two types of snails. Some curl out this way, and some curl out the opposite way. Okay, so you have left-handed snails and you have right-handed snails, okay? When it comes time to mate, a right-handed snail can only mate with another right-handed snail, can't mate with a left-handed snail, just things don't fit, okay? So the left and right, it's just, I don't know where this goes, I don't know so you've got to have the same kind. So that's assortative mating. And in a population where most of them are right-handed, the left-handed ones wouldn't have a chance.